So a very good evening to all of you. Welcome to yet another series of Ophthalmology Rewind. And on the countless request of a topic, I have come up with a very, very important topic today. And that is the visual field effects. Now, meanwhile, we will be discussing the visual field effects because you people have sent me so many queries related to it. I'll try to address all these queries in this. And if you feel that even there's something that you want to ask again, then you can tell me in the comment section. I'll check those messages and I will revert back. So let's start with the visual field effects. Now, before we address the visual field effects, you should know what is a visual field, because if you do not have the idea what is a visual field, then obviously your knowledge about the visual field effects will not be complete. So let us start with this, the normal visual field. Visual field is actually the island of the vision in the sea of darkness. So whatever all that I can see surrounding me, that is actually the visual field, the maximum that we can see superiorly, the maximum that we can see inferiorly, maximum that I can see nasally, and the maximum that I can see temporally is my visual field. Now, this visual field can also be divided into the central visual field and the larger one, that is your peripheral visual field. Like you must have seen that we discussed in so many topics that here there is a loss of central visual field whenever we have got optic neuritis, optic disc diseases, we have macular pathologies, then we have the problem with our central visual field, right? While whenever we have a problem with the periphery of the retina, mainly the rods, yes, what you always learn, C4 cones are present in the C4 center of the retina and they are responsible for C4 color vision. So always remember these three C, C for center, C4 cones and C4 color vision. While the periphery contains the rods are for peripheral vision or the dim vision. And we know that rods are much more than the cones. Even this is an MCQ. Which of the following is more? So rods are much more than the cones, and I think this is a common sense, because center, if the cells which are present in the center are there, and on one side we have got the cells which are present in the periphery, so which will be more? Obviously the periphery one. So in the periphery we have got large number of rods, and whenever there is a problem with these rods, the peripheral visual loss occur. Now there is a limit to how much I can see superiorly, how much I can see inferiorly, how much I can see nasally, and how much I can see temporally. Like we have got limitations in our visual fields. So how much it is? Now when I try to see superiorly, can you see we have got the limitation of the upper lid, and then I also have the limitation of this brow bone. So obviously my visual field is limited. Then if you see nasally, we have this nasal bridge, so there is a limitation of how much I can see nasally. Then see inferiorly. Now inferiorly, lower eyelid does not pose that much amount of problem, but the problem is the zygomatic bone. So there is a limitation how much I can see inferiorly, and we finally come to temporal. So can you see temporal is comparatively clearer, and we have very less of obstruction here, and that is why the maximum temporal field is there. So can you see here we have got four things. We have superior visual field, then we have got inferior visual field, we have nasal visual field, we have got the temporal visual field. And as I told you that the formula is SNIT. You can easily remember it by SNIT, means inferior and temporal are more than the superior and nasal, and whenever there is a comparison between the four fields, minimum is always the superior. This is always minimum. If you go with the amount, so we have got like 50 degree, 60 degree, 70 degree, and we have 90 degree. It is 50, 60, 70, and 90 for superior, nasal, inferior, and temporal. Right, it is something like this. Now, in some of the areas, you will see that they write both as 50 degree only or both as 60 degree only. But even then, you should know that the order will always remain same and minimum is always superior visual field. So, it's a good idea to learn this order as nit, minimum is superior, then is the nasal, then is the inferior, and then is the temporal. So now you got the idea that we have got four quadrants of the visual field, and you also got the idea that we have a central visual field and we have a peripheral visual field. Now, how much is the central and how much is the peripheral? So for this, remember that suppose we start with this central one, we have divided it into four parts. It is something like this. If you see this, so if I divide it into four parts, something like this, so this central one is called as the fixation point. This is the fixation point. Are you getting? This is the fixation point. And around this fixation point, our visual field is present in the form of isopters. Very commonly, you will hear this word with respect to the visual field. This word is called as isopter. Isopter of the vision. So we have got these rounded. Can you see these rounded that I'm making with the green color? These are actually the isopters of the vision, and they are roughly present at an angle of 10 degree. So we have got so many isopters like this. They are present in our visual field. So central one is your fixation point, and then every 10 degree we have isopters. So 0, then 10 degree, 20 degree, 30 degree, 40 degree, 50 degree, like this. So it is up to the 30 degree. See, this is the innermost isopter. So if you see here, this is your 10 degree, this is 20 degree, and this is 30 degree. So up to this 30 degree means from 0 to 30 degree is our central visual field. So in all the quadrants, from 0 to 30, 0 to 30, 0 to 30, and 0 to 30 is our central visual field. And from 30 degree to beyond, whatever you are seeing from 30 degree to beyond, that is our peripheral visual field. So I think this idea is very, very clear. Now, the next thing that is important is the distribution of the nerve fibers. Whatever is the constriction of this visual field, we are getting the contraction of the isopters. This contraction of the isopters is occurring due to the optic atrophy. I think this is the summary of glaucoma. What do we learn in the definition? It is optic neuropathy characterized by retinal ganglionic cell death by the apoptosis. So optic neuropathy is taking place. There is degeneration of the nerve fibers, and it is due to the degeneration of the nerve fibers that you are getting the decrease or the constriction of the visual field. So let us see what is the distribution of this retinal nerve fibers. Can you see this one now? Now, this is your optic disc. This is the optic disc, and this will be, therefore, opposite side will be your macula or fovea centralis, foveola, whatever you say. And what do you know? What is the basic concept? Optic disc is present on the nasal side. So this is the very basic concept, and macula is present on the temporal aspect. So whenever you see the fibers, you should know these are the fibers of which eye. See, whenever you are seeing the fibers, you have to consider as if you are facing the patient. So it is like this. You are standing like this and patient is standing like this, face to face. Okay. And this is your nasal side. So which eye this will be? Because you know that macula is always present on the temporal side. So this will be your right eye nerve fibers. So this is again a very good concept, because in the visual fields, it becomes opposite. In the visual field, it becomes opposite. Now I will show you one more thing before we go to the visual field, because I was getting so many questions related, why ma'am it is diagonally opposite. Yes, so I'll try to show you something. See, this is the human eye and it is seeing. So this is your point of fixation. This is your point of fixation, like this. Now if you go back to the retina, right, see here, we can divide it into this nasal retina and we have temporal retina. Okay, and because you know that the optic disc is present on the nasal side, so see, on the nasal side we have this optic nerve and its head is called as optic disc. You all know what is optic disc. Optic disc means optic nerve head. Optic nerve head, head of the optic nerve. And retina is extending from the ora serrata. Yes, what is the extent of retina? From the ora serrata to the optic disc. So this means this portion is actually the retina. This portion is retina. And then we have got this portion is also retina, right? I am making retina red here. Usually I don't make retina red, you know. I make choroid red. But because of the choriocapillary is shining, I am making the retina red here, right? And then it's the starting of this optic disc, going into the optic nerve. So can you see now this area there is no retina. This is the basic concept, and I can assure you that this will help you even in neuro-ophthalmology and here also, the basic and a beautiful concept. So here I don't have retina, that is a vacuum there. I am not getting any image formation there. Rays will also not strike there directly because there are no rods and cones and you do not have retina there. So that is why you get a blind spot which is corresponding to this optic disc. We are getting a blind spot in corresponding to this. Now if I am having this optic disc on my nasal side, so my optic disc of this right eye will be on the nasal side here and the optic disc of this will be nasally here, while the macula of right eye will be on the temporal side of the right eye, that is towards the right side, and the macula of the left eye will be on the left side. So this goes, okay. Now if you see here, this is your nasal retina. Now this nasal retina is corresponding to the diagonally opposite temporal visual field. So this nasal retina is corresponding to this. So if this is my nasal retina, how will it go? It will make the visual field corresponding temporally. So nasal retina is affecting the temporal visual field, while my temporal retina is affecting this nasal visual field. So if I'm seeing from this area, image will be formed in the nasal one, and if I'm seeing from this nasal area, image is formed on the temporal one. So now when you know that the nasal retina affects the temporal fields and the temporal retina affects the nasal field, now we'll go back to that diagram. Now see this, I am saying that we have this optic disc present on the nasal side. So it is present on the nasal retina. So the blind spot that you will get due to this, where you will get, in which visual field we will get the blind spot which is pertaining to this optic disc. So let us try to make this. Suppose this is the visual field which is relating, which is showing this retina, right eye retina, right? So this is a nasal part. Nasal part will represent the temporal visual field, and this was your temporal retina. This will represent your nasal visual field. Then we have superior and inferior, right? Now this retina, optic disc, I'm making this optic disc red, okay, like this. So this optic disc, because here is a vacuum, I don't have any retina here, So this will be presenting a blind spot. So in which field I will get this blind spot? So that is now very, very clear. Because it is present in the nasal retina, I will get this blind spot in the temporal visual field. Mostly it is between 10 to 20 degree. 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30. This is our central visual field. So mostly it is between 10 to 20 degree that I am getting blind spot. So see now, what are the questions that you have already covered? What is blind spot? Why we have blind spot? How to label the eyes, which eye it is, right? Why the visual field is diagonally opposite, and then in which field I will get the blind spot. Now, what is the full name of this? It is called as blind spot of the Marriott. Now, another question was, what is negative scotoma and what is positive scotoma? So what I tell you in the classes, that this is always a negative scotoma. This is called as negative scotoma. So let us see what is scotoma and what is negative, what is positive. Scotoma means where you have darkness, no vision, that is your scotoma. Negative scotoma, which is actually absent, where you cannot see, you cannot realize, you cannot appreciate, you cannot perceive. If you can perceive that there is a scotoma, if you can appreciate that there is a scotoma, if you can perceive that there is a scotoma in your field, that is a positive scotoma. If I cannot know, or I cannot see that there is a scotoma in my visual field, that is a negative scotoma. So we all have this blind spot in our eyes. But do you always appreciate that, yes, there is something where you cannot see, this is a vacuum, I cannot see this area? No, you can see whole of the room, whole of the area. So because this scotoma cannot be appreciated, therefore it's a negative scotoma. But the scotomas which occurs like in choroiditis, we are getting a scotoma that can be appreciated on the Amsler grid test, yes? So that is a positive scotoma. People are floaters. So at the area where they are having floaters, they cannot see anything. So that is a positive scotoma. So this is the concept of positive as well as the negative scotoma. All right. Now, see this. Another important thing is, how will you actually demarcate the areas of the optic disc? Because glaucoma is all about the optic disc changes. Yes, optic disc changes which are occurring due to the raised intraocular pressure and the optic disc changes leading to the visual field defects. I hope you remember the triad of the glaucoma. What was the triad? Raised intraocular pressure, optic disc changes, yes, and visual field defects. So this is a basic which have been asked even in so many exams also, right? So raised intraocular pressure leads to optic disc changes, and optic disc changes leads to visual field defects. So it's important to know the anatomy of the optic disc. So here we have the optic disc. Now can you see there is a cup shaped depression? This is the cup and the surrounding, this is your optic disc, and over this you have the major blood vessels. We have got central retinal artery, we have got central retinal vein, right? And the area which is present in between, this is neuroretinal rim. This is the basic anatomy of the optic disc. Whenever I want to see the optic disc changes in the glaucoma, I will use the instrumentation to see these things. How much is the disc? How much is the cup? How much is the neuroretinal rim? Right? And you should also know what is actually this cup. What is cup? Cup is just a hollow, because see this, you will realize it beautifully. What is this? Now see this. Can you see here? The front portion, from here you will see like optic disc. You will see it like the optic disc. So this area where you do not have the retina, when you see it from the front, that will appear as a cup. So basically, cup is just hollow inside the optic disc. It is nothing but the hollow inside the optic disc. You do not have any fibers inside the optic cup, and only there are vessels which are passing here. So what is the normal ratio? Normal ratio here, normal CD ratio. Normal CD ratio is 0.3 to 0.4. Now another important question. Ma'am, is 0.6 also normal? Is it normal? Now see, I will not say 0.6 is normal, because normal is 0.3 or maximum 0.4 only. But if I am saying that a person is coming to you bilaterally 0.6, no other optic disc changes, no visual field defects corresponding to it, no raised intraocular pressure, even I'm not getting any of the risk factors of the glaucoma, will you not say that this is normal? So basically what I say, the answer of a MCQ depends upon that MCQ itself. So some things you cannot take it to be generalized based on that question. So what is the mistake that you people do? Instead of doing the MCQ from the theory, you people change the theory according to the question. So it does not happen. Just on the basis of that MCQ, I cannot say that 0.6 is normal. But yes, the conditions that are given in that question, bilaterally 0.6, no other factors, nothing, no other changes. So I will say yes, normal, no problem. Okay, then another important thing. This neuroretinal rim that is given, the thickness of this rim is not equal. Can you see? Here we have thickness, here it is this thickness, here we have got this thickness, and here we have got this thickness. So the thickness of this neuroretinal rim is not equal in all the quadrants. Let us see how. It is something like this. So we have got four quadrants. Inferior, we have superior, we have nasal and temporal, and it follows the ISNT rule. It follows the ISNT rule. ISNT rule is normal. Now another important thing is that this ISNT rule is there normally. It is not in glaucoma. So glaucoma violates the rule. Glaucoma violates this rule. You have to be very, very clear that glaucoma violates the rule. Now what is this rule? That the thickness of the neuroretinal rim, if I go with the thickness, if you see the thickness of the neuroretinal rim, then it follows this order. Means this is maximum. It is going from maximum to minimum. So inferior is the maximum. This is one, then is the superior, then is the nasal, and the last is the temporal. So this means this is maximum and this is your minimum. So if you see a normal optic disc, you will get 0.3 to 0.4 and you will get maximum thickness in the inferior neuroretinal rim. You will get minimum thickness in the temporal one. And this is violated when we have got cupping and we have got glaucoma. Because you know that first there is a problem of the superior and inferior fibers in the glaucoma. There's a selective loss of superior and inferior fibers. So due to the selective loss of superior and inferior fibers, the cup is extended superiorly and inferiorly. And that is why what you are getting, we are getting extension of this cup ovally. So you are getting this extension of the cup ovally, and this is what we called as vertically oval cup. This is called as vertically oval cupping. So now you will get to know what is cupping and what is ISNT rule and why 0.6 is considered to be normal in a particular question and otherwise it's not normal, and how it is violated during the glaucoma. During the glaucoma it is violated, right? Okay, now we come to the this again. Now whenever we have to plot the visual field defects which are related to this, It is always plotted on the isopters, as you can see this. So this central one is your fixation point, and then we show so many isopters, 10 degree, 20 degree, 30 degree, and then we also draw a vertical line and a horizontal line. So we have a horizontal ref-way and a vertical, and where both of them are meeting, that will be the central fixation point. All right. Now let's try to analyze the visual field changes that are occurring. So I will first show you the total visual field. This is how we make the diagram. You can relate to this, yes? So I'm saying that this is my total visual field, because I am talking about the peripheral field also, and I am talking about the central field also. Now, originally I told you that there are so many isopters, 10 degree, 20 degree, 30 degree, but eventually I have made it horizontally oval. The reason is that there is actually selective loss of superior and inferior fibers. So because of this selective loss of superior and inferior fibers, the disc was showing optical cupping that was vertically oval. Right, cupping was vertically oval, and therefore the visual field that is there, that is your horizontally oval. So this total is the peripheral visual field, and in the center we have the central visual field. So obviously it is only one, but I have shown you so many because slowly and gradually it is passing with the several stages. So we will go with one by one. Now, actually what happens? When glaucoma starts, if you see what happens, this is your vitreous cavity backside like this, and it is going like this, and slightly nasally we have got this optic nerve. So whenever there is more of aqueous humor, due to the back pressure changes, it will go, and it is causing the peripheral retinal atrophy also. This will affect our peripheral visual field, and it is causing the compression atrophy of this optic nerve also, and that will affect our central visual field. So what is happening now, side by side, there is a problem with the peripheral field also, and there is a constriction of the central field also. So slowly and gradually this peripheral field is constricting, constricting, constricting. It is becoming like this, and the central field is also constricting. Now, if you see the central field, what is happening? Suppose this is your fixation point, and then we have got like a 10 degree, 20 degree, and we have got 30 degree. Okay. We also know that between 10 to 20 degree, we have got this blind spot. So when there is actually contraction of the central field, normally what happens? The visual field, suppose this is our central visual field, it is like this. So it is having this blind spot inside it, but when there is a contraction of this visual field, then it takes an inward curve, it takes an inward curve, and it leaves the blind spot out, something like this. So what it is doing? It is doing the contraction of the isopter. This contraction of the isopter is done from the periphery also and in the center also. So in the periphery, we don't have any problem. Our constriction means the extent up to which I could have seen now is diminishing, diminishing, diminishing. And when there is a diminution or the contraction of the central field also, the blind spot, which is actually present between 10 to 20 degree, I'm leaving it out. So this is called as bearing of blind spot. This is called as bearing of blind spot. So I hope this is very, very clear. There should not be any confusion. So when you leave the blind spot out, that is the whole area which you can see. This area is visible. It is not the scotoma. Scotoma you have left out. The blind spot was a scotoma and we have left it out. So the first thing that we were having was your isopter contraction. So we are having the contraction of the isopter. This is called as isopter contraction. And the second thing that we have is the bearing of the blind spot. Now, these two changes are very, very non-significant. As well as non-specific. Like, I could get this with the peripheral atrophies also. I could have got with the other diseases also. So, I will not say that this is glaucoma. Yes, it occurs initially in glaucoma also. But just on the basis of this isopter contraction or just on the basis of the second, that was your bearing of the blind spot, I cannot say that there is glaucoma. So these changes are not significant. So what is the other important question they ask? What is the first visual field defect that is visually significant? So it is not isopter contraction, it is not bearing of blind spot, rather it is a small wing-shaped paracentral scotoma. Now look here. Small wing-shaped paracentral scotoma. So this is your blind spot. So this one is a small wing-shaped paracentral scotoma. This is away, slightly away from the center. This is your fixation point. And it is occurring in the central visual field. Therefore, it is significant, but it is away from the center. This is called as paracentral scotoma. This is called as paracentral scotoma, and it is actually this paracentral scotoma which is earliest visual field defect which is visually significant. So this is again a very important question. Now this is the start of journey, because this was the first step. Now slowly and gradually it will keep on increasing. Scotoma size will keep on increasing. So how it is increasing? Now we have a paracentral scotoma and we have a blind spot. Now both of them make a union. They say that you are also a scotoma, I am also a scotoma, let's make a alliance. So they make an alliance and they may make like this. Can you see? We got a sickle cell shaped scotoma. This, in the next step, this is called as Siddle's scotoma. So this scotoma is called as the Siddle's scotoma. So another important thing is, what is the shape of this scotoma? Shape of this scotoma is the sickle cell shape, and it is formed due to the fusion of the paracentral scotoma along with the blind spot. Now, another important thing is that the area which is present, like this was your 0 degree, this is 10, 20 and 30. Right. So the area which is present between 10 to 20 degree, this area is actually the arcuate area. This area is called as the arcuate area. Now, what is arcuate area and how these fibers are presenting? Let's see this one, then we will come back. Now see this. We know that in the optic disc, we were having the retinal fibers. Like, now the distribution of these fibers is very, very significant. Those fibers which are present on the nasal side, they are the radiating fibers. They are the radiating fibers. So, superiorly, we have superior radiating fibers. And inferiorly, we have inferior radiating fibers. These are present on the nasal side, which is affecting diagonally opposite visual field, that is temporal visual field. While if you see on the temporal side, we have the arc-like fibers like this. These are the arc-like fibers, and that is why these fibers are called as arcuate fibers. So the arcuate fibers which are present between 10 to 20 degree makes the Jerram's area. Makes the Jerram's area. Jerram's area means central 10 to 20 degree area is called as Jerram's area. Here we have arcuate fibers. It is the temporal side of the retina and affecting the nasal visual field. These fibers are the fibers which are most sensitive to the glaucometer's damage. Now this is a key point. What I am saying, the arcuate fibers present on the temporal hemiretina between 10 to 20 degree, which is responsible for the nasal visual field, are the fibers which are most sensitive to the glaucoma. That means which field will be affected first? nasal or temporal? Obviously, the nasal visual field. The fibers which are affected first are the temporal fibers, and the field that is affected first is the nasal field. Now, come back here. Now, what we were saying, that after the sidal scotoma extend, it takes an arc-like turn. Can you see this? It is taking an arc-like turn like this. This arc-like turn which is making the scotoma is becoming arc-like. So, this is actually called as arcuate scotoma. This is called as arcuate scotoma, and because can you see it is between 10 degree. See, this is your 10 degree and this is 20 degree. It is occurring in Jerem's area. Therefore, it is also called as Jerem's scotoma. Therefore, it is also called as Jerem's scotoma. So, when there was a sidal scotoma, it was just the alliance between a paracentral scotoma and a blind spot. Now, they combined to form a sidal scotoma. Sidal scotoma was very small and now it is taking an arc-like turn. But it will not pass the horizontal raphe. Now, another important thing. It will never cross this horizontal raphe because the distribution of the fibers is like this. We have arc-like fibers like this. On the nasal side, we have radiating fibers. Temporal side, we have arcuate fibers which are ending at the horizontal raphe. Then we have another side arcuate fibers like this. So, this horizontal raphe means they will follow the rules. They will not pass, they will not cross this horizontal raphe. So, what if the inferior fibers are affected? So, if inferior fibers are affected, then we have inferior arcuate scotoma. When the superior fibers are affected, we have superior arcuate scotoma. Now, can you see? We can have a superior arcuate scotoma. We can have an inferior arcuate scotoma. Now, can you see? I am not making my hand like this. I am making the hand like this. Means, it's not mandatory that the arcs which are taken up by the scotomas are equal or they are running in the same arc. It's not necessary. They may go in different arcs. So, because they are going in the different arcs, can you see here? This is going in the broader one. This is this arc. While the inferior one is going in a different arc like this. So, there may be unequal contraction which is present at the horizontal raphe. So, this step which is formed due to the unequal contraction, this is called as nasal step. Another important thing that I received the message that you were not able to understand the nasal step. So, can you see we are getting this step, this due to the unequal contraction, this is called as nasal step, Roine's nasal step. Now, if it is occurring in the central field, it is Roine's nasal central step. If it is occurring in the peripheral field, Roine's nasal peripheral step. So, that is very clear. So, suppose a person is having an arcuate scotoma above and he is also having an arcuate scotoma below. So, blindness here also and blindness here also. So, where he can see just in the center. So, what is left here? Can you see? This area is visible to him. This area is visible. So, what is this vision called as? This vision. Can you see? They have shown you beautifully here. This was your nasal step arc. This is the step that is formed. And when hole is gone, the patient can see just in the center. So, when he can see just in the center, this vision is called as tunnel vision. Another very important DD, tunnel vision, or I can also say tubular. This is called as tunnel vision or tubular vision. Means if I see through a tube, I can see just the central portion. I cannot see up, down, nasal or temporal. I can see just mid, straight ahead. This is called as tunnel vision or the tubular vision. And then what is left in the last? Because arcs are forming nasally, therefore which field will be affected in the last? It is the temporal. So, can you see this? This was your nasal and this was your temporal. So, which is affected in the last? Temporal island of vision. So, it is the temporal island of vision that is there till the last and just before getting blind. just before getting blind, the person can see the temporal island of vision, our patient can see the things which are present in the temporal field. So which field is affected in the last? This was a direct question in NEET 2018 also, that which is the last to be affected, that is your temporal field of vision. Now see this, I've tried to show you what I mean by the temporal field of vision. Now see here, this was your step number one, where I have started seeing some kind of blurring of vision. Then it becomes more blurred, then it becomes more blurred, then we are getting more and more constriction, right? Then we are getting a very rough view of the central area, and finally see, there is a total absence of the peripheral vision. This just the central vision is there. That is called as tunnel vision or the tubular vision. This is called as the tunnel vision or the tubular vision. So now we will try to write them in stepwise manner, because nowadays they are also asking you the order. Arrange them in order. So what was the first one? First was the isopter contraction. First is your isopter contraction. Second is your bearing of blind spot, where the blind spot was getting out of the central field. Then was your paracentral scotoma, small wing shape paracentral scotoma. This was in fact the first scotoma that was visually significant. Then it combines with the blind spot, makes the Siddle's scotoma. Siddle's scotoma, that was sickle cell shaped. Then it is taking the arc like turn, arcuate scotoma, which is also called as Jerram's scotoma. Then it becomes the double arcuate scotoma, arcuate scotoma above as well as arcuate scotoma below. Then what is left is the tubular vision. What is left is the tubular vision. And last to go is your temporal field. Last to go is the temporal field. So this order is actually important. Now how will you learn this? This is in corona, bearing, patients should be done, to treat. So I and C, that means in corona, isopter contraction. B for bearing of blind spot, bearing patient. P is your paracentral, should Siddle scotoma. B, that is your Jerram scotoma, done. Double arcuate scotoma, 2. Now tubular vision left, then 2 treat, that is last to go is the temporal field. So this is one mnemonic that I made in the lockdown recently, so that you can learn this order. If you have any other mnemonics, you can make it by yourself also, but keep it very simple, because in the last, when we are there with so many mnemonics, we usually require one more mnemonic to remember that mnemonic. So be very, very clear. If you are able to remember it without the mnemonic, absolutely fine, not a problem. Okay, so this was there. Now, one more thing I wanted to show. When we are doing the investigation part, right? Yes. So when we are doing the investigation, because you know that basically when we are investigating the glaucoma, we are concerned with two things. Which two things? One, I am concerned with the optic disc changes. First, I am concerned with the optic disc changes, because these are collaborating with the visual field effect. So one, I have to see the optic disc changes, and second, I have to see what are the visual field effects corresponding to this optic disc changes. So how can I see these optic disc changes? Yes, I can see with the ophthalmoscopy, then I can do the confocal scanning laser tomography. But nowadays, one thing is very, very commonly done, and that is your OCT RNFL. So what is this? OCT is a popular name in the field of retina. You all know there we do optical coherence tomography. We see the different layers. We see the foveal depression, and we are able to label CSR, CME, ARMD, retinopathies, and so many things. But if it is able to show you the contours in the layers of retina, why not we can use it for the optic disc, because optic nerve is also one of the layers of the retina. So in the OCT RNFL, we are trying to quantify and measure the thickness of the this nerve fiber layer in the optic disc, starting from the innermost inner limiting membrane to the outermost, that is your retinal nerve fiber layer. And it is something like this. So when you do this, we also get a retinal thickness map. Can you see here? There we get a retinal thickness map. So they will give you exact values. What is the thickness? What is the symmetry? What is the rim area, neuroretinal rim area? What is the disc area? What is the average CD ratio? What is the cup volume? What is the vertical one? So every finer detail, because it's an automated machine, every finer detail you are getting. So you should know that how we are using it, and what is the sole purpose, what are the things that we can get, and we can quantify the thickness from that. And see this, they also give you something like this, means this is the scan of the optic disc, and then they will give you like this, where they have divided it into four quadrants. So they will show you that where you have maximum, this is, they have given yellow color, and the minimum ones they will give you the green color. So they will give you the color coding, plus numerically also they will give you what is the thickness in the particular quadrants. Okay, so this was about the optic disc changes. Now we will be talking about the visual field defects. So when it comes to the visual field testing, we know that we have got two kind of visual fields. We have got central visual field. We also have a peripheral visual field. So because I have got two kind of visual fields, one is the central visual field and one is the peripheral visual field, therefore I have got two kind of testing also. For the central, means 0 to 30 degree, I will be using campimeter. And for the peripheral field, that is beyond 30 degree, there I am using the perimeter. So this is the basic difference between the campimeter and the perimeter. Then another important thing is that there are two kind of perimetry. One is your static perimetry. Static, like we are using Humphreys field analyzer, automated Humphreys. This is actually the most commonly used nowadays. And another is your kinetic perimetry. Here in the kinetic, we use the Jerram's tangent screen, and then we also have the Goldman's. Though the Goldman is there for both, we have got Goldman's perimetry for both. So mainly it is used for the kinetic. Now what is the difference? See, kinetic means mobile, static means it is not moving. So in the kinetic perimetry, there is a moving stimulus which is coming from a non-seeing area to a seeing area. So there is a moving stimulus, and slowly and gradually the patient will follow it from a non-seeing area to a seeing area. That is your kinetic perimetry. While in cases of the static perimetry, there is a static stimulus. Stimulus is not going to move, but there is a change in the luminance or intensity. So there is a change in the intensity of that stimulus while the stimulus is static. So most commonly we are using this static for the glaucoma patients. So another important question that which kind of perimetry you are using in the glaucoma patients? We are using the static perimetry. We have got different instruments. You can see this. This one is your Goldman's bowl like, and this is your Tangen screen. This is called as the Jerome's Tangen screen, right? And these are the Humphreys. In the Humphreys, we have got different strategies. These are the strategies. We have got different strategies that we are using, like it can be white on white, and you should know the name, that Sita and Swep. That is your Swedish interactive threshold algorithm and short wavelength automated perimetry. So just you should know that these are the different strategies that are used for the Humphreys, and Humphreys is a kind of static that you are using, right? Now see this. This is the Humphreys, and you can see the plot. How do we get the plot? So though they will not expect you to read that plot and tell that what is present, but you should be knowing what are the sites. You should be knowing that this is a plot of the perimetry and it's a plot of Humphreys field perimetry. Now they may not give you which eye it is. So they can even give you the plot and they can ask you which eye plot it is. So that you should know, that which eye plot it is. Now see this. When you see this plot, actually it is considered that, see, fields may, it is opposite. It is considered that the patient is standing like you are there. So what is your right eye will be his. Your right side will be the right eye and your left side will be the left eye. So in the nasal fibers, you are considering that the patient is facing you. So it was the opposite. But when you are seeing the fields, you are considering that the patient is standing like you. So your right eye will be right side and your left side will be the left visual field. So that is, should be very, very clear, right? This kind of plots we get in cases of the Humphreys. So you should know which side of the eye it is and it which plot it is. Okay, then see this. These are the kinetic parametries. Though the this Jerome's Tangen screen we are not using quite commonly nowadays, but you should be able to recognize it. And can you see there, we have got a black screen and on which we have got the white concentric circles, and this is your central fixation point, this is your fixation point, and here we have got a white stimulus that is coming from a non-seeing area to a seeing area. Similar is your Goldman's perimetry, and can you see the baby seeing inside a cup? So we have a cup-like area in which the patient has to fix. This is your Goldman's perimetry. Now, important thing, because nowadays they are asking more and more clinical questions. Like if you remember, we had discussed yesterday that there was a question that what should be instilled first, an eye drop or an eye ointment, and after how many minutes. So what can be done in the visual field testing as the examination part, clinical examination, which you can do bedside to the patient. This is actually called as the confrontation. In this confrontation, we are actually using the moving stimulus. First of all, we are using the moving stimulus. And second important thing is, we are also checking the periphery here. So what we have to do, this is called as confrontation. So you are confronting the patient. Patient is sitting in front of you and you are also sitting like this, facing this patient. Now what you are doing, same side eyes are closed. Same side means opposite eyes. So if I am closing and covering my right eye, patient will be covering his left eye, and from this side, opposite side, we will be bringing our stimulus. Okay, keep it just in the center. sit at a distance, okay, at least 1 meter distance, maintain the social distancing, okay, and in the center keep this stimulus and start bringing. Okay, now when you are bringing it from the periphery and you are bringing it towards the center, now stop when you start seeing it. Stop when you are start seeing it. Obviously, we are considering that the visual field of the examiner, whoever is examining, is normal, and we are considering it to be controlled and compare it whether the say the at the same time the patient is also able to see it, or how much afterwards, how much you have to come closer that he start seeing. So obviously it's not that accurate, but it's a convenient method and a quick method which will tell you that the peripheral field as well as the central field is decreased in cases of these patients. So this was a quick and crisp discussion of the visual field effects. I tried to correlate it with the optic disc changes, with the visual field effects, what are the concepts related to the fibers and the visual field. I hope you liked it, and if you have any queries, feel free to ask me. You can tag me on the groups